Hello, and welcome to 5 Minutes of Postgres. My name is Lucas, and today we're going to talk about finding the source of a locking problem in Postgres. We'll start with this blog post by Jesse Soyland on the Crunchy Data blog. Jesse is a customer success engineer on the Crunchy team, and as part of that job, he often works with customers that have a locking problem. And in his experience, these type of issues can quickly take down an entire production database or application. Now, before we jump into this post, it's important to note that there's two different types of locks that we might be talking about when we talk about locks in Postgres. There's what's called the heavyweight locks, so locks that a user controls. This is, for example, if you say lock table, or if you make changes to a database that require a certain lock level. But these are all queries that you as a user of the database execute. There's also what's called LW locks, which are the internal locks inside Postgres. And so if you look at wait event data, you might find a particular LW lock that shows you the contention on a particular internal Postgres subsystem. And so what we're talking about here when we talk about locks is we're talking about the heavyweight locks, the user-controlled locks. The most basic way how you can debug a locking problem is you look at the pgset activity in pglocks views. Now Jesse starts by looking at pgset activity, and pgset activity shows us that this connection here is currently waiting for a lock on a relation. This is an alter table statement. This should be very fast, right? Because it's just doing alter table add column. Adding columns is an online operation. So this is generally speaking, not something that would be slow, but because there is a blocking lock, this is not able to succeed. If we want to understand why this is not succeeding, one of the ways you can look at this is you can search for this PID in the pglocks table. Pglocks is an internal view on the Postgres lock manager for heavyweight locks, and this is where you can go to find out which process is holding which locks, and also which locks are granted versus which locks are still being waited on. We can start by saying for this particular process, this particular connection, which of the locks are not yet granted? What are you waiting on? Here we can see that it's waiting on a relation lock. Relations are tables in this case, could also be an index. And so it's waiting on this particular table with this particular ID. We can utilize this to say which other connections, which other processes are holding that lock. In this case, it gives us a single connection. That's the problem. We can then look again at pgset activity. We can identify that it's actually an island transaction connection, which just didn't commit this transaction, which presumably did some kind of modification to that same table. And so that's why it's blocking that DDL statement. There are various ways of running lock queries that help you do this more automatically. If you have a monitoring tool, you could have that run automatically in the background. This is one version of that type of query. In the Postgres Wiki, there are different lock blocking queries. We'll get to a little bit more of that in a second. But let's say you have identified which process is blocking things. Really, then you have to think about how can you end this process? How can you have the thing complete that is blocking? And so, of course, if it's an idling transaction, if you can, you could make a commit on that transaction if you have that level of access. You could cause a rollback. Or if that doesn't work, you can do either a cancel backend, or in the case of an idle transaction, you actually have to do a terminate backend, right? Because cancel backend, that is going to cancel a query. But if it's in that idle transaction state, you actually need to terminate the connection in order to get out of that state. In this particular situation that Jesse is describing, we would have needed to do a terminate backend to resolve the problem. Now, Jesse mentions two more things that I think are helpful for a lot of us that run into these problems. First of all, you can enable a setting called log lock weights. And this I would basically say anybody who runs a production Postgres should enable this. And for example, on Crunchy Bridge, this is actually enabled by default. What log lock weights will do is it will cause a log event to be issued in the Postgres logs every time a lock is being waited on for more than 1 second. This is controlled by the deadlock timeout in Postgres. Even though it's not a deadlock, it runs on the same schedule. If things are slower than 1 second in terms of lock weights, then this is a great way to find out about that. It will tell you which statement is waiting on, which PID holds that lock. Another way to get more safety here is to add a lock timeout. Imagine that you have this migration where you're doing this alter table, and you think it's safe to do the alter table, but actually, because of a concurrent operation that's still holding a lock, the alter table is really slow. If you set a lock timeout, that means that you return early with an error, similar to a canceled statement. And so you will know pretty quickly that there's a locking problem. And so especially for migrations, it's a very good idea to set a lock timeout, make it 10 seconds, make it 30 seconds, but have a way that the system doesn't just wait forever for some internal issue and then potentially causes downtime. Now, I do want to talk a little bit more about the implications of schema migrations or DDL statements waiting on other activity to complete in order to do their work. For this, I want to go back to a very good post that Nikolay from PostgreSQL wrote a couple of years ago, where he talks about different queries to analyze what he called Postgres lock trees or lock queues. In this blog post, he describes how you have to be careful that there's different layers of lock weights. And so just because one process waits on another process doesn't necessarily paint the full picture. And so lots of details in this post, but ultimately what this shows here is a tree of lock weights. In this example here, we have an update statement that's ultimately the holder of the lock that's of interest. We have a delete statement that's waiting on an update statement. Then we have an alter table statement that's waiting for both of these to complete. And then, and this is where it gets really tricky, is you have two select statements that are also waiting. And this is the thing that's really surprising to most people, is that you would think a select statement, it's not modifying anything. Why does it need to wait on these other modifying statements? And the problem is, unfortunately, because you have this alter table statement, even though this is an add column, for a very brief moment, this will need an exclusive lock on the whole table. And so that means at that very brief moment, no other select statement can be running. And so the way that Postgres queues this for you is that it says, well, let's have this update statement finish, let's have this delete statement finish, then run the alter table, and then let all the selects run. But that means once you have an alter table waiting on other activity, it's very risky because it causes these select statements to also wait. And I've seen production outages just caused by this little detail. And so you really want to be careful that when you're seeing lock problems in Postgres, that you respond quickly, in particular when it's about exclusive locks taken by table migration. And so because this is so complicated, we actually ended up building a dedicated lock monitoring feature in pganalyze. And I just want to show you a quick example of this because I still use this frequently and I think it's really useful. And so what this does is you have a UI that says this particular statement is waiting on this particular other statement. And this is able to traverse the lock tree or the lock graph. And so I would say if you're running any kind of production Postgres database, it's very important to have monitoring for block sessions and to know how to either run a manual query for you or to have a product like pganalyze that can do this for you automatically behind the scenes. Thank you so much for listening. This was 5 Minutes of Postgres. Subscribe to our YouTube channel to hear about next week's episode and talk to you next week.